voice for around 30 years in a lot of different departments.
Yeah.
Systems analysis, management consulting, program management, commercial and business processes. So you've been all around. I think in terms of the agenda today, using data across the organization, this supporting various decisions and so on, is within your field. Of course, what you're going to talking about is also from your work from the University of Durban, the School of Computing and Business since 2002, where you've been working with big data analytics on especially these the undergraduate and graduate postgraduate line, teaching analytics and governance.
Yes.
So, with no further ado, I think the stage is yours.
Thanks very much, Jonas.
Thank you.
Yes, just as a quick word, the PDF of the slides and the notes that go with it are already up on my website back in the university, and I'll let Lisa and Management Defence have that link very shortly. It's also been videoed, and you'll be able to find it on my YouTube channel, Richard Self, University Derby, and you'll find the video there in the next couple of days. Just takes a little while to upload, it's rather big. So you'll be able to get back at this very easily. So you don't need to take photos of the slides at all, because they're low quality normally. Yes, I've been involved with, as Jonas introduced me, data across the company. My very first job after university was material forecasting from the bill of materials breakdown, looking ahead 5, 10 years. 20 years for the full engine programs, and that was my very first job out of university. And that was kind of interesting. I then learned the forecasting hockey stick, which was something that was quite fun, to realize that the front end, well, the back end always shows this great steep growth, and it comes moving like this all through time. So I've been playing with data quite successfully almost all my life. And then one of my daughters is very heavily involved in the financial industry, financial services industry in London, and she kind of introduced me to the idea of governance, and I've kind of followed that. Because yes, we can do fantastic things with data, with analytics, AI. But one of the fundamental things I'm going to be introducing today is yes, we can. We need to think very carefully about should we? And I'll show you some examples where quite clearly we shouldn't. I'll also show you some examples where our AI systems learn things which you don't intend, and I'll explore why that might be, so that we can again ask the right sort of questions. And I'll also put it in the context of GDPR. But as leaders in your industry, in your business area of analytics, I want to think about ethics, how you maybe think about, as a leader, embedding changes in the way that you and your staff actually operate to reduce risks to your organization by more effective, more ethical use of data. And I'll introduce at the back end the impact of GDPR, in particular to the phrase, the intent of algorithmic transparency. Now, it's a leadership development session, so I need to start with a little bit about leadership. I want to look at some of the real critical aspects of leadership that make changes. And I'll refer briefly to my own journey over the last 3 or 4 years to kind of illustrate how things work if you have the right sort of leadership. And then I'll move on to the field of analytics data, analytics governance, trust, ethics, because that's what we do. One of the most important parts of our undergraduate and postgraduate programs, which is almost unique, not quite, but nearly, is that we embed ethics, trust, and governance into both our undergraduate analytics programs and our master's programs. There's even a module in our master's program, just analytics, ethics, trust, and governance, a whole 20-credit module. And it looks looks, and we have to think about that in terms both of the data that we're using and the algorithms that we are using. Now, moving into leadership, are you just a manager herding sheep, trying to get them to go where you want them to be? But sheep, like cats, kind of go off in random directions. I'm not saying that managing is not important. It's an important task. But perhaps leadership is the better way to go. My sheep know my voice, and they follow me. So what is it that makes them want to follow you? Five ideas here about leadership. In strategic planning, we talk about the corporate vision or the departmental vision. We need to know where we want to go. It's like trying to guide ships around the world. There's a lovely picture of a supertanker. You need to know well ahead of time where you want that supertanker to go, because you cannot spin it on a sixpence or a euro cent. They take a while to change. Many of you have been involved in business process re-engineering projects in your company. And yes, we can do the tech, the SAP, the ERP system in 18 months. That's a classic time frame. But if we're going to do a proper BPR, we have to change the hearts and souls of our staff. We have to do that change management program. You've all been there, have you? And it doesn't take 18 months, does it? It takes 2, 3, 5, 10 years. Lou Gerstner discovered in IBM during the 90s when he introduced a new change program. Yes, after 10 years, a single contact per company, rather than 10 product-related account managers. Even after 10 years, only IBM North America had truly heart and soul bought into that change program. All the rest, yes, they knew the answers. They could tick the right boxes in their tests. But they still didn't believe single point of contact was the best way. They still hankered after the old product-based account management. It takes forever. So you have to have this long-term vision, otherwise you're in the problem area trying to spin on a dime. If you are going to influence your staff in the right direction, to follow that vision, you have to have that passion in you about what you want them to do, about where we're going, a passion about that vision. To do that, you have to be able to communicate effectively. And communication is an interesting art. There's a lovely example, and I use this regularly, about a senior politician in the UK a few years ago who had this idea of his. And he spent a lot of time talking to audiences about this idea. And he was rather surprised that nobody in the audiences ever bought into his ideas. So his response was, "The audience must be thick if they don't understand my vision." Now, politicians are in the business of communications, aren't they? They are there to persuade people of their vision, their ideas. But he forgot that most important lesson of communication. It is the communicator's responsibility to communicate. It is his or her failure if they don't grab the attention of the audience and persuade them. So to lay the blame, if I don't grab your attention and you go to sleep, is not your problem, it's my problem. And he forgot that lesson. You have to be able to communicate your vision effectively and persuasively. And that's why, actually, a slight digression, we teach our analytic students, yeah, they can go learn the techie stuff, it's easy, there's lots of training material, but the things they need to become effective when they come to work for you is that they can communicate, that they can tell the story. So most of our work in several of our modules is mentoring, helping them to communicate, develop the structure of their presentations, and then tell the story that really is powerful and persuasive. So that's what we're trying to do for you guys. They need courage. Because some of the things you're going to do, the directions you want to go, as leaders of the companies, leaders of your departments, are going to be directions that the bosses are kind of a bit nervous, the shareholders might be a bit nervous about. You know, we heard just now, in the next conference room, about moving our private, personal data, personal information data into the cloud, into a data lake. People get seriously nervous about that. You've got to have courage to convince them of the security of the data lakes in the cloud compared with your own data lakes inside your own infrastructure. Amazon Ireland have more security people working on the security of their platforms than you could possibly afford to employ. So courage is required. And the final one is, as a leader, you need to walk the talk. And by that I mean, be able to say convincingly and persuasively that the rules for me and you are the same. We've all seen situations where there's one rule for the bosses and another rule for them and us. Security. I remember when we first at Rolls-Royce introduced portable laptops for the travelling seniors so they could maintain email. This was back in the mid-late 80s. When you had to connect to a modem to your phone and so on. Yeah. Or, as one of our seniors discovered, if you have two little pins, you could actually poke into the wire, actually, and connect up without the modem. But there was a rule, which we learned through the bitter way, that you do not let people load games onto the company machines. This was back in the mid-80s when there was a beautiful game called Leisure Suit Larry. Does anybody remember that one? Anybody heard of it? And as you got right to the last one, most versions of Leisure Suit Larry, when you got to that top one, they zapped your hard drive. Remember that bit? This happened several times, so this was when the rule came in. Now, one particular director, he was a young one, he loved playing games on his PC at home. And now, he was on the road, in the aircraft, for weeks on end. So, well, there's this rule for them, everybody, but I know what I'm doing, I'm senior enough so I can load it onto my laptop so I can play games when I'm bored in the evening in a hotel. We all learned the lesson very, very quickly that this kind of applied to him as well, because we all learned about how frequently his laptop got rebuilt. Yeah, we have to, as leaders, walk our talk. Do what we say. One rule for all. However, are those five attributes sufficient? I think not. I think there's another pair. Inspiration and empowerment. With those first five attributes, we need something to convince those around us, those below us, to follow. Now, I've been University of Cambridge, Jesus College, back in the early 70s, spent 30-odd years at Rolls-Royce Aerospace. Every job was new. Most of them were ones that I was allowed to make what I could. I was inspired, I was empowered. A little bit of control here and there around the edges. And then went to the University of Derby back in 2002. And I found both at Rolls-Royce Aerospace and latterly in the University of Derby, that power from those above me to inspire and then empower me was interesting. That's why I'm here today. There are very, very few academics who get out to business conferences like this. But how did it happen? Well, about four or five years ago, I forget exactly when, I'd been working part-time in this School of Computing, part-time in the School of Business, and eventually, about 2012-13, I came back at full-time into the School of Computing and Maths. Now, before that, I'd been kind of pretty much the classic academic. Essentially, most academics work within a field of comfort, their narrow area. Now I have a fairly broad area because of my business background that Jonas mentioned. But I was still, you might say, a technical expert, and I was trying to manage the students. So I had a three-hour sort of seminar on IT governance. Well, there's a half hour in the middle where they could sort of wander off and have a cup of tea or coffee or something, and then they'd come back. But I got all this lovely stuff in my head to transfer into their heads, because it was good for them, and it was good that they knew the stuff. Now, if you go back to your university careers, one of the things we learned was that lectures aren't actually terribly effective. It goes in one ear, but 99% falls out the other ear before you even left the lecture. And it's very difficult to get them enthused. It's very difficult to get them to engage very, very much. About 4 years ago, the guys above me, the departmental head and the deputy departmental head, said to Richard, "What did you change? We'd like you to think about changing to a different approach." And rather than essentially teaching the content, because there's stuff out there they can go learn, I mean, our students don't learn, we don't teach our students SAS. We say, here is the SAS 20 chapters and all the exercises. Just go and do that, because otherwise it's 35 hours of my time, and that's a whole semester's module. It's wasted my time, wasted your time. We've got much more interesting things to do together, exploring stuff, ideas. So what we've been doing, what I was allowed to do, was to change from teaching content pure and simple, essentially to mentoring the students to develop their soft skills. Curiosity. Yeah, if you think about most of our schools, junior schools, high schools, they do a staggeringly good job of beating curiosity out of kids. You know the two-year-old, why? You answer, why? You answer, why? You know, that never-ending question. By the time they come out of high school into university, you don't see it. It takes an awful lot of effort to get that curiosity into how the world works and what the data means. But for example, I was doing some work, got some students to do some work last year, and they were supposed to be looking at a large set of data about tracking people through Beijing. Microsoft collected 1.5 gigabytes of data, 17,000 journeys around and about Beijing in China. And basically the data is latitude, longitude, altitude, and a timestamp. I wanted them to find out why there were some problems with the data, what sort of problems and which were the problem observations. And the curious thing was, they just treated it like the sets of data. They never connected it in their heads until I pointed out to them that actually, as you move along a journey from point A to point B within every second, there's some real-world physics. Like, if it's on a light railway, metal on metal, it's never going to accelerate or decelerate at more than 0.1 g. Otherwise, it starts slipping. If it's a human being and your interval is 1 second, yes, you could probably get someone like Usain Bolt accelerating at 0.5 g, or maybe more. And they couldn't make that. They didn't understand that the simple thing was, first of all, think about calculating distance, velocity, acceleration. There was no connection in their mind, no curiosity about what the data really meant. So mentoring them to think about curiosity, critical thinking, problem identification, problem solving, communicating, and then telling an effective story, a persuasive story. That was what I was freed up to do because I was empowered and inspired to do something like that. And then, 3 years ago, after I'd got my LinkedIn site kind of profile working effectively, connecting to my YouTube channel where all my conference videos are, whether it's an academic conference or this conference presentation, I've got videos of almost everything I've done outside and my lectures. Suddenly, out of the blue, middle of an afternoon college away day, comes this email in from a conference organizer saying, Richard, we'd like you to do a presentation on this at some point in time. And suddenly, that snowballed, and within 3 years, I'm now involved with 6 business conference organizers, including management events. And I could be heard by more people this way than if I was a pure academic, where my paper would be presented to the session stream with the 4 presenters, the chairperson, and 3 other random people sitting in. And the papers being published in the academic quality. Journals are seen by 3 more PhD candidates researching. I never gets out. There's what, 40, 50 or so people here, 100 and something today, most of whom will hear this. That's more than I would ever see or affect or influence if I was a bog standard academic. So inspiration and freedom and empowerment are important. Now the interesting thing is that was from above to me. What has actually also changed dramatically, which has improved the success rates of our students that I teach and the way that the students are taught by others with a sense of style, is that we have now got modules which have some of the highest pass rates in the university and pretty good satisfaction. Because what I do is to set them a big challenge. So in the context of today, the advanced analytics module I'm teaching finalist students, I'm not teaching them anything. I'm pointing them to sources for them to think. They get 10, 20, 30 links from Data Science Central a week of interesting stuff going on in our field. And they have to, over the next 10 weeks or so, identify an interesting advanced analytics capability. Could be image recognition, image analysis, it could be text, it could be semantic analysis, predictors, clustering, who knows? They can go choose something. And then they have to pretend they're a chief data officer, go find a big chunk of open source data that's out there, and a vast amount. I'm not going to tell them which is interesting to them. They can go find it. Then they have to choose 2 out of about 6 or 8 different environments. Python, SAS, ClickView, etc., etc. And do a comparison between the 2 for the type of data they want to play with, and then do a capability analysis. They are going to be giving most of the presentations during this lecture sessions over the next 6-7 weeks. Now what this does is means they are, I'm empowering them and inspiring them to go find a project, a problem that's interesting to them. Now the fascinating thing is once you do that, they engage with the problem that you set them, which is this big thing. They find this little thing and then they go do. They learn languages that they have to. So one of the ones, several students want to do image analysis. Now, there's a library in Python which is magical for doing this, and you need about 9 or 10 lines of code, calling the relevant functions, to do an image learning type of analysis. They've not done Python, they've just done SAS so far. And they will do that, those who are interested. And it means they really engage with the subject very, very interestingly and very, very well. But module averages, I know about into the 75%, which is, there's only about 10 modules in the university to get that sort of high level. So I am taking from above this inspiring bit and putting it down below. Is there a lesson for us all that we need corporate directors, executives, who are inspiring us to inspire below, and they can then inspire below. So we inspire our team leaders, who then inspire their staff, their team members. Moving on, there were all those ideas about leadership, inspiration, empowerment, and trust. You've got to trust as well. The rest of what I'm going to talk about is questions. Lots of questions. And to some of you, it may seem remarkably cynical, but remember, I've been in this business now for the best part of 45 years, on and off. It's actually deep level of critical thinking and what you might call skepticism. We can, but should we? We can, but what are the consequences? Now, I don't know how many of you are sort of chief information officers, chief data officers, are you at that level or a little bit below? How many are at the CXO level? Anybody? A few. In the UK, and I think the regular laws are similar across many jurisdictions, the UK Companies Act 2006, section 172, has an interesting, unfortunately not enforceable at law, but a very strong recommendation, that executives need to consider, when they're making decisions, the likely consequences of any decision in the long term. And I want to concentrate on that one and the item E, the desirability of the company maintaining a reputation for high standards of business conduct. We've seen many examples recently where both of those major criteria seem to have been forgotten or not thought about. We all know what's been happening to Uber over the last 8 months or so. Not a happy story. Partly because of that, Transport for London have declared Uber not fit and proper to conduct business in London. This may or may not change in a court battle, may or may not change the result of discussions between the new head CEO of Uber and TfL. Who knows what will happen? Governance, trust, ethics, analytics of data, algorithms. Very briefly touch on security and privacy, and then some of the GDPR consequences a little bit later. Now, one of the problems about our data, how many of you as the experts in your company have kind of had a discussion around about that sort of perspective with some of your, of what you might call customers for your analytics? Or much more importantly, do we really understand the accuracy of our data? Or how biased our data is? Because unless we recognize the biases in our data, the analytics are going to play and learn biased answers. And under GDPR, this might be an unfortunate consequence, particularly if the answer, the decision that comes out of the machine automatically conveyed to the customer, then damages something in their life. Ultimately, if things go really, really badly, think 20 million euros or 4% of world turnover. Unless you know what the data is like, there are some very unfortunate consequences. We collect data from everywhere. I was at the management events equivalent of this session last week down in Zurich. And there was, on the presentations, was about a company that was pan-Europe, certainly around the Latin areas of Europe, using data collected from cars. Do you know how accurate the GPS data is that you're collecting if you want to use it? How accurate it is or how inaccurate? We kind of tend to think that the data from our tills and our corporate ERP systems is accurate. Perhaps. How many have got a fitness tracker or use a fitness tracker at some time? Do you know how accurate those are? And if you are a company that makes these and is selling apps providing apps to go with these fitness trackers, do you know how inaccurate they are and how misleading they are to your customers? Because if you don't, you might have problems. If you want to use your smartphone or your customer's smartphones to do location-based target ads, do you know how inaccurate they are or what's going on? You know ThinkNear, don't you? You've seen ThinkNear's report, I guess. 10% of all location target adverts in the USA are targeted more than 100 kilometers from where it was thought they should be. Think reputational damage. Don't worry about 20 million euros or whatever, just think reputational damage. Veracity problem. We kind of like to think that our data is accurate. When I first saw this back in 2012, 2013, when John Easton was presenting it at a SAS conference, or it was referred to as a SAS conference in Europe, in England, back in 2012, he said 20%, only 20% of our data we know is accurate. 80% we have no idea. We don't know which is wrong. I'm not saying 80% is wrong. But about 80% you have no idea whether it's right or wrong or indifferent or by how much it's an error, if it's an error. And I looked at the enterprise data and thought, oh, that's about 20%-ish, so it must be enterprise data is accurate. And then I was talking to people who'd done the usual ERP implementation. And before they do that, you clean out, 60, 70% of your master data? Because it's old, out of date, and you can't prove it's right or not. So you only put 30% of the data into your new ERP system. And I thought, hey, SAP, it must be okay. And then I started hearing from people that within 5 years, many companies are starting up new data cleansing exercises in their master data in SAP or whatever. And it takes a lot of hard work. And if you get it wrong, if you just bring in a few contractors to do the job who don't know your business, they have a magical ability to make the problem even worse. Then you have to get your own experts, functional experts, and people in the departments who understand their data to do the job properly. And the problem is we don't really know which data are right and which are wrong. So the consequential question is, when we do all of our management analysis, our beautiful predictive analytics and so on, how do we know how much we can rely on those analyses? Now, I'm not being cynical here, I'm saying, but there is a skeptical question to be asked. From a governance perspective, you need to understand, if you can, the levels of inaccuracy and then ask the very, very important consequential question. If we have this amount of data which skews our decision making, is that giving us a management problem, a governance problem? Now, if you're Starbucks and 5% of your target adverts go 100 kilometers in error because you've got better technology than in the States, is that a problem? Well, the worst is going to be a reputational issue. You're going to upset a small number of customers who will just switch off these ads. This has no real significance. But if you are a transport management company and you're taking readings out of the GPS tracker in the cabin, in the cab of a lorry, it's kind of unfortunate if every now and then you get a GPS reading which accidentally says the last 10 seconds they've been doing 100 miles an hour and this is illegal. at a company near Derby discovered this. And now, on the fly, as they get the data coming back from all of the lorries in the fleets that they're managing the data for, they do a consistency check. And if it indicates ridiculous velocities or randomly different places, they ignore those data very quickly. They did a governance overcheck, finding out how to identify, as far as possible, where the problem areas are, to reduce the risk of problems. So, yes, we have a veracity problem. It's not an argument for saying we won't do the analytics or won't use it to make decisions. It's to prompt management to understand the consequences of basing analytics on questionable data. Its consequences, don't say, don't do it. Work out what the consequences are of different levels of error. Location service, bottom left. A tracker, a hand tracker, on a table, 24 hours, one second intervals. Error, circular error, roughly 3 meters either side. Not bad. The right-hand one, same tracker in a conservatory with a bit of glass and a bit of plastic on top. And as you can see, the error is considerably greater. I was first triggered to this by the top left. I took some photos down in Chile where I was on a conference and took some photos and discovered one of them was 22 kilometers in the wrong place. Which then led me to think, hey, there's an interesting project for students because you can take lots of photos, places you know, and then you can kind of understand what's going on. And what we discovered with location tagged photos on smartphones like iPhones and Galaxies and so on, was 85% of the photos taken indoors, outdoors and everywhere were within 25 meters of where they were. The problem is in those remaining 15%. So I've had one or two photos up to 1,000, 1,800 kilometers wrong. Okay, that's a special situation. But it kind of makes the point that if you've got a single point, you don't know how accurate it is. The top middle one, the wandering one, while I was standing up there for about 3 or 4 minutes in TK Maxx, a bit of a metal shed, so not ideal for picking up location data. And it took me for that long walk, about 100 yards to there and back again over 2 or 3 minutes. Location data off your mobile phones is kind of interestingly inaccurate. And I've got students now working on ways to try and work out whether we can identify anomalies fairly easily. These gadgets are seriously inaccurate. 30% difference in step count between a VivoFit and that, my phone. Pretty random. We get lots of data out of social media for content analysis, sentiment analysis, and so on. And many people are trying to work out from the tweets and all these other sources about how do our customers out there perceive our products and our services. And there are some people out there who have forgotten if they ever learned anything about statistical sampling and experimental design. And they say, does that matter? Because we've got all the data there is. We've got N equals all in statistics terms. Yes, you have hoovered up out of Twitter and Facebook every single reference you can find that your APIs will allow you to get hold of and fees to the companies about my product or my company. Yes, you've collected all the data that's available, but is it biased? Is it representative? Go back to a marketing course I went on at Rolls-Royce in the mid-80s. The point was made there very, very clearly that if you look at customers, a customer who is unhappy with products and services will tell at least 10 people about their dissatisfaction. If a customer is happy, gets what they expected, Well, they might tell as many as 3 people that they had a good experience. And what we've known from blogs and all of these sort of systems over the many, many years is that the number of people posting and tweeting is actually a very, very tiny proportion of our business customers. And mostly, they're the ones who've had a bad experience. So N equals all for everything I can scrape out of the ether, but N equals 0.001% probably of what's really important about your business, that 99% of people are happy. They're getting what they expected. And if I've received what I expected, why on earth should I bother to go and rate them somewhere? You've all been there, haven't you? How many of you ever rate an average or the expected service or product? Very few. If we have been really upset, it really didn't work, yeah, we'll get back onto Amazon and rate the product as absolutely rubbish. Please, folks, don't buy. Just read that. How many of you in the analytics space are using clustering in all its many forms to find out what's happening? This is an example of clustering where we're so close that the AI can kind of, oh, it's all in the same cluster. Cappuccinos and espresso are the same thing. They're just coffee, aren't they? Yes, clustering is an incredibly important technology. But we need to get inside our technologies to understand what it's doing, because humans separate out an espresso and a cappuccino, two incredibly different things. And if your AI, your clustering technologies, have put them all into one big cluster called coffee, it's not going to be ever so helpful unless you want it to do that. Now, it may well be that you're trying to separate out coffee and tea, in which case that's perfectly acceptable. The question is, do we really understand what our AI, let's put all of it into AI or predictives, are actually doing? Because if we don't know what it's doing, we can get ourselves into trouble with our customers. Lots of algorithms. We've seen all sorts of things happening over the last few years. From Cambridge Analytica, who are alleged to have helped with the Trump campaign and with the Brexit campaign with personalized SMSs, which by another name probably could be called political advertising, which is not entirely illegal in either country. Activity trackers, they have some interesting adverse consequences as people have developed commercial business models around it. Target, you remember probably some of you what happened there with pregnancy predictions. Yeah. And then you think about recommender systems, the things that sort of in Amazon say, oh, and by the way, you should be thinking about buying this or that or the other. And they're working on using that sort of system to actually, as you log in, to say, oh, and by the way, in a couple of years' time when they've got their little drone technology, we're just about to order for you such and such a product because we think you're about to buy that, and then we'll deliver it in an hour or two. How many times have those recommender systems, wherever they are, really been successful? And one of the things we have to remember, of course, is that it works part of the time. And the question in a governance perspective is, are the business benefits of those few occasions when it works enough to outweigh the other adverse consequential costs when it doesn't? Like, customers may get fed up. We may be overbuilding our inventories. So, I'm not going to cover these because I haven't got very much time, but they're in the slides, the notes below it mention various provides some background, and you can follow up the links. The only thing to say, comment here, Michael Kaczynski, and we'll come back to him in a few minutes, looked at Facebook and the likes, your likes that you put on Facebook, discovered that 88% of the time, if someone had done more than 69 likes, he could predict your skin color 8% of the time. And then that technology was used by Alexander Nix for Cambridge Analytica to do their political analysis. Target predicted women who were pregnant based on their spending habits and other data in their supermarkets. They could identify which trimester from very early on. They could identify later on in pregnancy which month they were going to deliver. They sent out books of tokens, and people found this a little bit disconcerting and unfortunate, and they kind of stopped the program pretty quickly when the sky fell in on them. Health track and activity trackers are interesting. The top two photos identify the fact that businesses are now, insurance companies are now using tracker data to set discounts for insurance. The way they do this is say that if you've got a tracker and you meet these activity targets week in, week out, you keep your discount. If, however, you fail to meet your target for a particular week, there's a £12, €14, €15 penalty per week. And for the dog, there's even one for dogs. And there was an example about 6 months ago where a reporter took them up on this, got the gadget to fit under the dog's neck, and that particular dog needed 70 minutes exercise each day. So they fitted it, took it out for, they knew, 80 minutes of activity, and at home they downloaded the data onto a smart app, hoping to see the 70, 80 minutes that it had done, and were a little bit upset when the gadget had recorded all of 5 minutes activity. The bottom one, however, is even more consequential. There are a lot of people who are using these Fitbits to look at not just the steps, step count and distance count, but also the calories. And they set themselves a target, and if the tracker said, oh, by the way, your target is 2,500 and you got 4,000 today, the natural response of many, many people is, oh, I can have a blowout so I can have another Big Mac. And what we're finding is that people with fitness trackers are actually putting on weight. Now, three adverse consequences because of the inaccuracy of these things. The calorie count that comes out of a fitness tracker is almost meaningless, because you cannot easily tune it for your actual biological efficiency. What we've discovered is that if humans start reducing their calorie intake, the human body switches into more and more and more efficient mode. It takes the calories out of your food even more effectively. And so it's very difficult to lose weight purely by reducing your calorie count, calorie intake. Because your body says, got less coming in, need to be more efficient. Machine learning, do we know what is actually learnt? Here's an example from the American military teaching image recognition to detect enemy and differentiate from friendly tanks. They did the usual sort of training, training set, and test set. So you normally get your whole set, take 80% for training, and then there's 20% reserved for testing. So it's the same population. Shoved all the data in, worked a treat, learned it, was absolutely perfect, or very nearly perfect, filled with the test set. Then accidentally, they discovered that it had learned something, but not what they had wanted it to learn. Even with supervised learning, this problem would have happened. It had actually learned to detect the difference between forest and desert. Those metal things in the picture were kind of ignored, they weren't relevant. The story doesn't explain or doesn't say how they discovered what it had learned. Because, of course, neural networks can't tell you what it's learned, it just does stuff. But they found out, fortunately, before they sort of fitted it to the Tomahawks to go and kind of take out enemy tanks. That was fortunate. We're not always so fortunate. We've also seen in the last few months tales, verified tales, where we have seriously biased and even racist face recognition systems. Do you remember this? There's a TED talk mentioned. That Guardian link there is to a TED talk, ultimately, it leads you to the TED talk, by Joy, PhD researcher Joy Boulamidwini, who was trying to do something with face recognition for her studies, and discovered it would not recognize her face. It couldn't see black faces. Now, relatively inconsequential for some things, if this was part of your security intrusion system, it's kind of unfortunate that it can't see black faces, dark faces. People will learn very quickly. One of the problems we find with a lot of these technologies, people learn very, very quickly how they work and then game the system. Last week, two sets of papers, what, two papers from academics, one last year, one this year. The left one, AI can be trained to detect, at least in this population, or I forget what the age range is in Chinese faces, criminal or non-criminal, with 89.51% accuracy. Or on the right, a paper which was done by that guy earlier on, Michael Kaczynski, gay or straight. Now, the ethics here is not necessarily about whether that research should or should not have been done. It's kind of difficult to stop research, whether inside your own labs, your own organisations, or in academia. The question comes in what you do with it. As Kaczynski on the right pointed out, there could be some interesting and very, very unfortunate and unwanted consequences if we started implementing that. Think of governments who want to implement one or the other of these as you come into their country through arrivals. I can think of several countries who would love to have the left-hand one, and as you get towards passport control, excuse me, sir, or other one or two countries I can think of who might like the right-hand one. Excuse me, sir, we don't want you in our country. And you can see the same sort of thing is being developed. Now, should we be doing that? Bear in mind, the left-hand one is only 89.5% accurate, so that's a false positive of something like not quite 11%. What about the people who are misidentified? Think GDPR at that level. If you are using it, then cause adverse consequences to European citizens, think GDPR. Because you cannot explain how those two are making the decision. You have no idea what's going on inside those advanced analytics. All you know is you trained it to 89.51% accuracy and 10.5% inaccuracy. Or worse, for the gay straight one, 17% of women will be miscategorized. What adverse decisions might you be trying to do with that? Hopefully no one will do that. No, not now. Sorry, just going to have to close it, not close it down.
Did you make it switch off?
No, I don't think I've made it switch off yet. Not yet. No, it's what's happened is that it wants to do a major update. I can't find where the... Mouse. Who's learned the lesson that the failure of IT is proportional to the importance of the event? Oh, it's over there. Ah, right. Oh, so, yeah, it's one of those ones that extended. Oh, you have to go the other one. That one, yeah. So close that up to full size. Now, with a bit of luck. We'll have to restart that one then. So if you just reattach it there. Let's see. Talk about security, lots about that, but it's quite important. We've had the catastrophe of Equifax. We've had just discovered today that Yahoo didn't lose a billion sets of data, they lost every single person's data. Problems with GDPR. Use of algorithms, the fact that most of them are highly opaque, the fact that we can try to collect all the data, the fact that having caught data, we then use it for other purposes which may not be part of data protection regulations. We collect it with specific intention generally, and if we repurpose the data, that could be a problem. And we're using lots of new types, which is why GDPR has developed. I want to look very briefly at that use of algorithms and the opacity. Now, all those examples I've given, I'm showing and taking you through, there are problems of understanding what our technology has actually learnt and how it's making those decisions. Because under GDPR, from the other side, the private individual, if the machine is allowed to make a decision, basically it's been trained in one way or another, but then we allow it to run and just make the decisions with no human oversight, if I feel aggrieved, can come along to you and ask you to explain precisely how it made that decision. Now, as experts in the field, that means you need to think about using these amazingly powerful and valuable tools if you're using them with personal identifiable information. Remember, that includes IP addresses, MAC addresses, as well as other things. And you are making decisions that are going to affect human lives, particularly adversely. You must be able to understand why, in this specific case, my case, it made that decision that is adversely affecting my life. A failed credit rating or a failed credit application or something like that. Do you know how to explain simply what it's doing? There's lots of good advice. My time is run. Are you going to be the leader, and where, and how? Or are you going to stay a manager herding from behind? And in what direction? Just a quickie, some very interesting books I've read over the last few months. And Weapons of Mass Destruction is a fascinating book. It's very cheap on Amazon, by Cathy O'Neill. And it takes very much, or poses many of the questions that I've posed here about the inherent bias in all of our data. The inherent bias of many of our machine learning techniques, either because of our bias as trainers, or the bias within the data. I hope that's been interesting, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.